Good morning. Thank you for joining me again on TMI Tuesday, 22nd day of September. We've got 3 days past the election day. Before the election, there were many, many issues about how it's going to pan out, different predictions, different ideas about the election being preceded by violence and what it could be prone to. But well, we had the election and a winner came up, and the person of the state governor, Mr. Godwin Obaseki, that polled 307,955 of the governorship candidates of the PDP, and using that to defeat his rival, who is of the APC, Osaige Ezeyamo, and he polled 223,619 votes, and the difference of about 84,336. Well, we are addressing that. We are looking at the appraisal of the electoral process that came up last week, Saturday, and joining me in this appraisal, starting from my extreme left, I have a political analyst, Frank Ehiosun. Thanks for coming, Frank.
Oh, quite a pleasure.
And next to him, I also have another political analyst, Idris Zekeri. It's a pleasure to have you join me.
Thank you so much. It's good to be here.
Okay, I start with you, Frank. Looking at what transpired, what do you make of this electoral process that came up last week, Saturday?
I think the mood of the people, as in across board, even on the side of the party that lost and those that won, and the masses in general, as in tells the full story, and that there's excitement, there's some sense of joy, because to a very large extent they can affirm that the process was free and fair. At, like you said just now, that there was anticipation of some heated exercise because of the intensity of campaign and possibly the tone of campaign at some point. But the election day came, people turned out to vote, and it's victory for the masses. I think it comes to give credence to the fact that democracy is about the people, where it is the people that make a choice of who to lead them. However it goes, they have the right to so do, and they expressed it on that day. Fundamentally is that INEC equally must give you some credit. Of course, if you go by reports from most observer groups, international and local, National Association of News, I don't know what you call it, yeah, a media man, I can't remember the exact name.
Okay.
The news agencies, the media folks. And now, yeah. Across board, the opinion is commendable, as in that INEC performed, the election was peaceful, even the security agents, as in, were relatively optimal. So I think everything added up to the fact that the election was a success.
Okay. Before the election, there were issues, skirmishes of violence, and some we are thinking that political pundits, we are thinking that this election could turn violent. What's your perception in that direction?
Well, Zekeri. First of all, let me congratulate my brother Ehiosun and congratulate Edo people. I'm congratulating Edo people because of the way we conducted ourselves. There was no violence.
Okay.
There are several issues that one would want to raise, but
substantially there was no violence.
Yes, there
substantially.
Was no, largely.
Okay.
There was no violence, and even the threat of violence, you see, as we approached the election, began to come down and down and down, and eventually there was no violence. And we thank God, because you can there will be election in another 4 years, but you cannot bring back life. So we are happy that no life is lost as a political party and as an organization. That is more important, more than every other thing. As to the conduct of the elections, well, there are several issues here and there, but it was a proper election. There were two major contenders, and at the end of the day, INEC declared the win. I want to commend the president because the fear had always been that there will be intervention here and there.
With the use of Edramite.
You know, they actually sold that dummy to the people, and to God be the glory, they are the one commending the president now. The governor had glowing praise for the president. Well, the position of the party officially is that they will study the results and take necessary actions where necessary. And of course, there are a lot of places to study in the results. So I will not contravene the position of the party. As for me, I want to thank Edo people because if you look at that result, you see that there were about 530,000 voters. And in that numbers, 223,000 thereabout voted for our party. Those 223,000 persons were not imported. They are Edo indigenes who believe that our agenda was a better agenda. This is according to INEC. So we will also, the experts will look at the results, and where there are issues, of course, they will do the needful. But for me, I think we as a democratic party, as a party that is civilized, every other thing that should be done will be done in line with the constitution.
Okay.
Yes, I wish I could even tell our supporters that by the stroke of the hand, we can turn the result and it will favor us. But that would be constitutional, is a constitutional impossibility.
Okay. So I'll come back there. Thanks, Zachary. But let's also, in the area of the violence that some expected would become the order of the day in that election. But we remember vividly the summoning of the governorship candidates of the PDP, the APC, by the Benin monarch, the Oba of Benin. And now there are also other key elements that we could also say played out in turning out substantially the election not being violent. What do you make of those stakeholders?
I think they did what they could. It's wonderful. But I'm giving these expressions with some peculiar reservations.
Okay.
Even when I made commendations, as in gave commendations to INEC and other institutions, it was, I could say, for the sake of it, peripheral. Because if we want to X-ray issues from the standpoint of a serious nation state, we must measure actions against fundamentals as it pertains to relevant laws or what is expected. So it's, even if we say, okay, yeah, Tango was peaceful, was it supposed to be violent? Is it not a shame to Nigeria as a nation state that 60 years after independence, every time there's an election, people's BP go high? Some people end up in hospital because of mid-election. For me, it's a big shame. We are not even talking about Europe or America or Western countries. Right in our sub-region in West Africa, they do elections in Ghana. They don't declare public holiday. They don't tell people not to go to work. They do elections in Togo, in small countries around us. So that's why I made reference to the fact that though we give commendations because of where we are coming from, because they say in the land of the blind, a wild man is a king. So even if things are not where they ought to be, you say, okay, since one person can see,
and we can appreciate
that effort. But it's quite unfortunate.
Okay.
Now, before I go ahead in this line of argument, I want to make one small emphasis with reference to the past election.
Okay.
The 2019 election, the budget for INEC was 189 billion. Political experts have affirmed that Nigeria's election is the most expensive in the world. Is it not an unfortunate contradiction that a country that is the poverty headquarters of the world wastes money on things that are supposed to be normal? India has a population that is 6 times that of Nigeria. Their elections are not as expensive, not even close to that of Nigeria. That's why I said, even when we are commending INEC, it's not something to celebrate, because it's not where we ought to be. The election postponement of 2019, for example, where it was postponed on the very day, that was not the first time. Same thing happened some years earlier. Just to reference the fact that a country that is the poverty headquarters of the world throws money into the water without any consequence. Economic statisticians affirmed at that time, on conservative note, that by the postponement of the election in 2019, from February 16 to February 23rd, now, on conservative note, it cost this country about $1.5 billion. My brother, the money that Nigeria is going to borrow from external sources, there's one now that I read about 2 weeks ago, that some experts have said that that's one of the reasons why they increased the price of fuel, electricity, and what have you, to give validity to reputation as per repayment package from institution we get it from. Now, you want to go and borrow sometimes 1.5 billion, 2 billion. But in one day, you just postpone the election recklessly, and by conservative estimate, the same country that is borrowing $500 million, $1 billion, threw away $1.5 billion. That's why I'm saying that our election process right now is unfortunate. We want to do elections calmly. It shouldn't affect businesses. America's election is coming up in November. But in about 10 states in America, they've already started voting. The 8th Assembly passed the Electoral Act. It was available as of 2019 before the elections. The excuse the president had at that time was that it was too close to the elections for the INEC relevant folks to adjust to it to be difficult. Let's leave it till after the elections. This is 2020 coming to an end. The electoral act has not been passed. Let me tell you, if that act had been passed, with electronic voting being captured, the cost of election would have been reduced by more than one fourth. How can we be the poverty headquarters of the world?
Okay, but we can't lay credence to that statistics if you talk about being the poverty headquarters.
No, you can't do that.
We can't lay credence to that statistics because we're looking at what the federal government is doing in that regard. So I think it will not be sellable. To say that.
It's not about whether it's sellable or not sellable. Well, we can link it to statistics.
But just go to the point.
What you said just now.
We are praising the electoral process.
I know.
In those states.
The electoral process peculiar.
Okay.
It accommodates all possibilities. Because the political process is the peak of the activity of any nation. That determines what goes on in every sphere.
True.
That is the truth. In 2019, for example, economic expert, it was in the reports that because of that postponement and a number of other factors in that election, capital imports declined by 25%. Foreign investors look at what goes on in your country. They look at the way you do things. If there's normalcy, there's consistency, I'll come and put my money in your economy. But where there's no certainty, where things could just upturn suddenly, I wouldn't have the confidence to show you. So if you want to extend election as a culture or a way as things people are elected, you must wait against all the other things that they impact upon.
Okay.
That's why I'm telling you that, yes, we are commending INEC, commending the police, commending most of the agents that were involved in this election. But that commendation is not to say that we are happy about where we are. That's my point I'm driving at.
Because we are not still there yet.
There was an election in Kogi and Bayelsa barely less than a year ago, a few months back. We saw the ban that came from the US. Was it not because of an election? If the conduct was proper, will a foreign nation be placing visa ban on people that participate in the election? So the fact that those things zone is cool and peaceful, and I mean, personally, I'll give the utmost credit to those state citizens, because when the people are duly mobilized, that's the good thing about the campaigns that took place. When competition is stiff, it gives the people the power to be the center of attention. So everybody is struggling to get their vote. So in this victory that, in this peaceful election that we had on 19th of September, the utmost credit must be given to those citizens.
Okay.
That they woke up to their responsibilities.
Thank you.
And pursue what they
Thank you. Idris Zakari, let's look at the aspect you congratulated the Edo citizens over this victory and giving a second term mandate to the governor of Edo State, Godwin Obaseki. Now, yes, I'm driving it somewhere.
Okay.
Now, a lot of persons, observer groups, have adjudged this electoral process as free and fair, using some indices, some elements, some factors. Would you subscribe to that?
Well, let me quickly correct an impression. I did not congratulate Edo PDP.
No, I said Edo
PDP. I did not also congratulate our people for giving a second term mandate to the governor. There are issues that only the experts can handle. I'm not an expert in law, and I'm not an expert in electoral law, of course. But I commended the people for the peaceful nature. Because, truth be told, results can be announced and there's protest and there's violence and, you know, all of those. Those are what we do not want. Because at the end of the day, we are one person. The circumstances that surround us is the same. We buy, whether you are a PDP member or an APC member, we all go to Selu Market or Oba Market, as the case may be, to buy tomatoes, pepper and onion. We all pass through the roads. If there is flood in your road, you drive a car through it, you're a PDP member, I drive a car through it, I'm a PDP member, it will all face the same consequences. You understand? At the end of the day, we all go to the same mechanic. We all have to pay the mechanic. And in any case, as much as I know, political parties don't put money in people's pockets. You have to find a way to create your own source of income so that you can take care of all these very important things in your life. Now, as for judging the election as free and fair, I think it was a proper election. When I say proper election, it means that there were two major contenders who ran for elections, who spoke to the people in an atmosphere that was calm, who marketed themselves to the people, and at the end of the day, INEC, you know, did coalition and announced results. Whether that result goes down well with us or not with us is a case for another day. So
Do you have any grounds as per what transpired that generated this?
As an individual and as a Democrat, I don't have a. Of course, what will you be having grouse about? What do you need to fight about? There were issues, but whether there are enough grounds to. And in any case, when you have grouse, you take it to the court of.
Okay, but you see the electorate, because political pundits, political pundits have said that the electorate took ownership of the election.
They have.
And
they have always
did
taken
you
ownership.
See that play out?
I'll give you instances. In 2007, the electorate took ownership. It was stolen by a political party, and it was recovered in the courts. So the electorate has always taken ownership. In 2016, in 2012.
So in this case, the electorate has taken ownership.
So the people, election, politics is about the people. At the end of the day,
you made mention of 2007. Now we are
2012
or 2012.
Yes, that's
what
the
about
public governor's
2020.
The people still went to
ownership.
When you say the electorate took ownership,
okay,
on both sides, you must also realize that people voted for party A and people voted for party B.
Yeah, across board.
It then means that those who voted for party A believe that party A had a better plan for the state than party B, and those who voted for party B believe that party B had a better plan for the state than party A. At the end of the day, a simple majority, as announced by INEC, believed that the PDP had a better plan. Now, whether that is correct or that is not correct is a matter for the experts to handle. Those who will look at it and say, okay, there was overvoting here, there was no overvoting here, there was violence here, there was no violence here, or there was intimidation of voters, there was no vote buying, no vote buying. That's for them.
Okay.
For me, my joy as an Edo person is that no Edo youth sacrificed his life for this election.
Okay, looking at what the chairman caretaker committee of the APC, Mai Malabuni, congratulating
yes.
The governor over this election winning, and then the president Muhammadu Buhari,
yes,
also hailing INEC and congratulating the governor.
Yes.
What does that depict in terms of
They have spoken for themselves and the positions they occupy.
Themselves, not for the party.
No, they spoke for the position they occupy. Mai Malabuni is the governor of Yobe State,
yes,
and the caretaker chairman of APC. He has congratulated the governor in his capacity
and not as
the president has commended. Yes, he's a party chairman, of course, caretaker party chairman. So he has commended the governor in his capacity.
Okay.
Same with the president. As president, of course, he's the president of everybody. He's not the president of APC. He's not the president of PDP. He's the father to all. And you see the way he has treated everybody as equal. Because at the end of the day, just the same way that I would suggest to the governor that he is governor to everybody. Now, there are key things that he should quickly make open to our people. First of all, the mega manifesto should be put in the hands of people. When I was preparing to come here this morning, I went online to try to get the mega manifesto, because it's upon that premise. If he survives the legal hurdles, if there will be, it's upon that premise that we begin to engage the government.
Legal hurdles,
if there will be.
Okay.
Now, it is upon that premise, that manifesto. Now, we will now begin to look from page to page to say, you promised this, you have not done it. You promised this, that's how we now begin to engage government. So, they should deliberately popularize the mega manifesto, their mega manifesto. Also, they should there are 5 markets that got burnt in Benin. 5 markets. So elections are over. There's no time for politics again to start pointing fingers. It's time for you to go and rebuild those markets so that our women can sell. All the street lights in Benin are still not working. It is time to power them so that the street lights in Benin can work.
So
we have left politics.
Stricter sense of what means is that there is work.
Yes, we have left politics now, focus on governance.
Okay.
Look, you can be happy. You had a Sunday to be happy, Monday. Today is Tuesday. For the voters, they voted on Sunday, rejoiced on voted on Saturday, rejoiced on Sunday. As we speak now, we are all back to work.
Okay.
You have to go back to work.
Thank you.
So
thank
there
you
is work to be done. Let's leave politics, let the governor focus on governance.
Okay.
While the party on the losing head now, according to INEC, will do their research, check, and if there is room, if there are grounds for argument, they argue it constitutionally.
Okay, there were some laudable, some achievements, like you said earlier, that in as much as there are some applause on INEC as the electoral umpire over this election, but we are not there yet, so it's not what we should be happy about to that point. But let's underscore INEC in this Edo governorship election that went on Saturday last week. In respect of the smart card reader, there are issues. Various political party spoke about it. What do you make of the development so far by INEC in terms of the functionality of the smart card reader in this election?
By available reports, it is clear that if you want to rate the performance of the smart card reader, there was one expert I watched, in fact, is a consultant, I think, with INEC. I watched it on Channel TV some days back, okay, 2 days ago. And he affirmed that the performance on that level was about 90%. And where I voted, and most people that I conversed with, as in asked about how their own took place, they didn't have issues with smart card readers. Of course, it's a mechanical device,
but
so there's room for flaw. But you know, the INEC rule makes provision for replacement. It's very clear in their guidelines at the 2019
electoral
election.
Guidelines.
It doesn't, it did change in this election. If the candidate doesn't quite function, they try it on a number of persons, on and on and on, and it doesn't respond, there's only room for replacement. The PO would connect with the SPO, and the info would be done. They normally have results. In a state election, most observer groups and interested parties commended INEC with reference to the performance of the smart card readers.
Okay.
That's the truth. There were some cases, no doubt, where, of course, like I found earlier, it's a mechanical device. There could be a fault. But there's clear provision for replacement.
Okay, but do you see those abnormalities enough to disenfranchise the voters?
No. I don't think so.
Okay.
The primary purpose of the card, as stated in their guide, I think it was section 11, subsection D of the last one they produced for the 2019 elections, it was stated very clearly that the card reader must read a card. That's the requirement to vote.
Mm.
The only challenge that comes up sometimes pertains to authentication. If the thumbprint cannot be authenticated by a smart card reader, there's provision as far as the card, the person's card has been identified.
Valid.
He can vote. There are provisions where you no see them from anymore, but there are provisions in the register the PO will give you to write your name and phone number.
No incidents from anymore.
Of course,
what do you make of that development?
No, it's a good one. We're making progress. That's why I said just now that the president should sign the electoral act into law. If he doesn't want to, I wish the National Assembly wake up to responsibility and go by the requisite majority as required by law to bypass him and pass it into law so that we can cut down the cost and the burden of some of the discussions we're having will not even come up again because things will go on smoother. There will be less human interface and better efficiency. It's not good to be taking shortcuts on and on and on, and we are making the journey much longer. Discussing one issue year after year, election after election, it's very, very unfair.
Okay, Idris Zakari, let's look at the aspect of voter apathy.
Okay.
Did you see voter apathy playing out in this case? Because we understand, like the records before INEC, having about 1.7 million PVCs already been distributed, and we have about over 400,000, 480-something thousand, not getting to the prospective voters, which were later disenfranchised because of that aspect, and the pandemic also contributed to that. So a measure of that, and also a measure of the vote cast, the population, voting population that turned out, would you say there was voter apathy?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
When you consider the number of persons that collected PVC vis-a-vis the number of persons that actually came out to vote, but the, we had substantial number of persons coming out to exercise their franchise. And unfortunately, there is a group I would like to use this opportunity to talk to, those who believe that votes don't count and they will never vote. You know, they just believe that who don't win, don't win. I've met them.
This mentality is
Some people sit in their houses and expect to win elections. You expect your candidate to win elections.
They could be seen as observers.
You are observing from your house.
To watch, to see.
I know a number of persons, a night to election, went to buy fuel to power their generator. They were preparing to watch movies. On election day. And you come out tomorrow and shout, hey, government this, government that. Who are you deceiving? You are not part of the process, and you want to make commendation. You know, everybody in Nigeria is a political analyst. Everybody in Nigeria has the better knowledge of how to run the state, how to run the nation, better than even the Mr. President. You stay in your room or stay on social media. Social media, that's the height of it.
That's a fulcrum.
As you are talking now, if you are streaming live, go and check. You will see more comments than the votes cast in a particular unit. So you go on social media, you lament to the right, you lament to the left. On election day, to come and make your decision, you will sit in your house.
Okay, but don't you think
some took PVC to open bank accounts.
Okay, but don't you think that again there should be more electoral reforms in this direction to make voting convenient?
Will electoral reform,
like you made mention of if they are to social media platforms,
yes,
they easily do that.
Yes,
you know, but because they are not living.
Okay, should we set up INEC Facebook?
What do you have to say in terms of electoral reforms to make voting convenient?
The question is, should we set up INEC Facebook? Another Facebook that will be doing INEC. You vote through Facebook. Of course not. This is not BB Ninja. What we are talking of a proper election where you go to the field. Everything that has value takes your time, takes your effort.
Mm.
And this last election wasn't so bad in terms of a delay. You come, you accredit, you vote, and you go.
Mm.
But people will sit in their houses and say, oh, this, our votes don't count. Oh, and you know the frustrating part of it, when they are the winners, and as they are the first to come and start abusing those who took position. You sit on the fence, you are neither here nor there. And when votes are cast, you come and start abusing the side you think lost. If this other side were declared, you'll be abusing those other ones. No. Our people must know, especially young people. I know I'm saying it. Because when you go to the village, you see EA of 90. We take his PVC. EA's PVC is usually cleaner than our own, we young people. Their own, as they are finished voting, and they will tie it inside leather bag and put it up. In the next one, they will bring it out. It's as new as the day I gave it to them. So our people, especially our young people, you must possess this democracy. In 2023, it's an old man that will be president again. I'm not a prophet, but I'm prophesying. You know why? Because the young people are not ready.
Okay, well,
stand for something.
I'll come back to you on that. There's a lot to that because money politics is also really inhibiting the younger generation from embarking on that. But we'll come to that. We'll address that. So let's look at the voting population. Do you see voter apathy, and what elements could you ascribe to that?
No, there wasn't voter apathy. If you go by statistics from the beginning of this fourth republic, there isn't any peculiar tilt as it pertains to the voter turnout. The total vote cast 2020, if you look at how it was in 2016, it was a marginal difference. Okay. As I said, there is no voter apathy. In Nigerian history, from independence till date, there's hardly been a time where voter turnout was more than 40%. Dating back to the First Republic, you go check out the data. There's hardly been a time where the average voter turnout across board was more than about 40%.
But this again also shows to a point where we can say that political participation again by the populace is still low, and judging by that percentage.
Now, this percentage, though unfortunate, but even if you go to Americans or those Western countries, there's been some decline in the young voter turnout too, even when the process is free and fair.
But not as bad as this.
I'm not saying it's as bad, of course. It's not as bad.
No, 60-40 is a disgrace now.
Okay, 60-40,
no. But like I affirmed, in my opinion, I don't see a party. But that doesn't mean that the process cannot be improved upon.
Okay.
To ensure that there is some sense of inclusion where everybody takes ownership. That's what makes democracy to thrive.
So what do you think in your views could be the elements to improve on that?
See, one of the yardstick I think that would ensure that is to improve on the index of transparency.
Okay.
And the easiest way to do it is to implement some of the reforms that were recommended by how many committees that have been set up. The one by the former Chief Justice of Nigeria, the late Chief Justice, West.
Okay.
There have been a number of them, as in very consummate and relevant recommendations that will make elections worthwhile in this country. Because, let me give you a simple example. Why do we always have the fear that there can be some influence from possibly the federal level? Isn't it because it is the prayer by which the presidents are appointed is simply by one man, and the guarantee of their being returned again is equally by the same man? It's not that we are saying the president should not appoint them, but there are prayers that can be put in place to open it more to some level of the inclusion of all stakeholders. Imagine, for example, that if the president wants to appoint officials in INEC, all the political parties would have stakes in the membership. Association of writers and as a media folks will have stake. Youth organizations will have stake. When there is enhanced participation of all and sundry, it makes it more difficult for the process to be contrived. That's what I'm saying, that there should be a promotion of some sense of inclusionness, as in across board.
Okay.
And there are so many documents to that effect. They have them in their, they are white papers everywhere. Different committees set up by different administrations. Yeah, the white one was very, very wonderful because when they won his election, he admitted to the flaws that took place in the election. And that's when he set up the panel. And he's been passed, he's passed on now for many years, by a decade or thereabout. Until date, the documents are on the shelf. It doesn't have due impact in the electoral process. Mm. See state election. For the past 20 years, everybody is complaining that one state six, in quotes, conduct elections. The party,
the ruling party in that state wins all the everything.
No, it has been like that. Okay. And nothing is done about it. Mm-hmm. But to address that stuff, it's very simple. All it takes is to, what makes these people so committed that they have no alternative than to ensure that the ruling party wins is because they are tied to the
government in charge
of the government of the day. If you don't promote inclusion as a subject of improved level of people being included, stakeholders, it will be possible for them to want to pander towards the disposition of the power of the day, because somebody is representing the youth group, somebody is representing journalists in the same body will say no. That is how democracy works in other countries. It's not because they are white or they have special color.
Okay.
It's because they structure the process to ensure that bottlenecks are pushed aside and transparency is enhanced.
Okay.
Thank you. To what, he said something concerning markets, markets are bonds. The state government is very committed. I know about some, apart from the what is on ground, as in strategies to improve on the level of ensuring that markets are safe and such things don't happen. But I think that on this platform, I'm sure that after we leave, the insurance people will come in. It's funny.
Yes.
Sometimes I say this country, I say it's a comedy of sorts. You don't have any serious nation state where insurance is not a serious policy that is enhanced by law.
I agree with you on that.
Those markets are burning. The money those people are paid as insurance is pittance. Pittance. And should the market burn, the insurance company will do the needful.
Mm.
Look at the other funny part of it. Once the framework is enhanced and people pay for insurance, you have never seen market burn. Because the conditions for the insurance policy to take effect, they are certain fundamentals.
Yes.
When there is no security in the market,
yes,
there will be security. When there is no light, there will be light.
So
when there is
power stations protected, fire stations and
so it's a show of shame that in the 20th century, every day fire burn. Let me give you a simple.
But you see the government looking into that direction?
Yes, but they have to. See, Governor Washington is a contemporary guy. Let's give it to him. That is why he has some stakes that I'm happy that people are bought into, because he's not going by the old order. He has everything blueprint written out.
Okay, but some will say, why wasn't this followed even at the first time?
No, it's see, the last time we only went together, when we were making predictions about the election, I gave GO 70%.
Mm.
And I felt that you can't be good in all. The areas where you have shortcomings, but when you have a pass mark of 70%, it means that you have done well, though you failed in some areas. And so you can't get it all across board.
Mm.
Now, my point is this. Tunde Bakari, I will make reference to him. I watched him live on TV when he was giving this testimony. He said that his house got burnt. No, when he went to insure his house, his friend called him and said, you are going to pay insurance for house, not life. What are you okay?
You can see the idea.
No, he's a pastor, a man of God. He has faith. He's a man of God. He's going to be Bakari. He said he told his friend that he's going to pay his insurance. In that, on that day, even made reference to insurance in the Bible. Guess what? His house got burnt. He said when his house got burnt, he didn't come to the church to make an announcement that
his house got burnt.
Collect the
insurance. He said in less than about 2 months or so, he had a brand new apartment to use.
So these are the positive sides.
Now, his friend who was mocking him that how can you be going to pay money for insurance? Not that the money is big, it's small money. He said not too long after that, it was on live TV. The guy's property got burnt.
Mm.
He had no insurance.
No.
He had to go and look for tens of millions to beat himself.
Wow.
So this market burning on and on and on. We should be enlightening the public. The insurance people policy should be enhanced to ensure that everything, see, even up to force, people buy force that is they insure it. So if they steal your phone, you are not bothered.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kesha, just joining us as TMI Tuesday, and we are looking at appraising the electoral process that came up last week, Saturday, the governorship race in Edo State. And I have been speaking with Frank Hilson, a political analyst and a politician of the PDP, and also, of course, with Idris Zekary, a politician of the APC, trying to close the gap or the lapses that could exist in the electoral process. Now, let's look at this, Idris Zekary. Quite a number of persons or political pundits were a bit taken aback over the decision of the presidency not to deploy federal might into play. Some political pundits believed that that affected the process of a particular political party emerging victorious. What do you think?
If you had mentioned names that Mr. ABC is unhappy that a federal might was not deployed, I would have spoken to Mr. ABC. If you had also been able to define for me what it means by federal might, I would have been able to explain why it was not deployed. However, I think the best any government can do is to provide security.
Okay.
Yes. INEC is independent, independent National Electoral Commission. Independent both in nomenclature and in nature. So the term of the INEC chairman is guaranteed by the Constitution. The president can't wake up and just remove INEC chairman. So I think the best the government can do is to provide security and provide a level playing field for both sides.
Do you applaud that position?
Yes, I actually think even in that, it favored our people more because they now deployed their state might, the local might, and intimidated voters and did all whatnot to get their result. But
I don't mean state might.
The governor,
because just now we're talking about the electorate taking ownership of the electoral process.
Yes, we are
now.
When is the proper election? When there is contest,
can you explain the air?
When there is contest, that's a proper election. What if one of the candidates was locked up or all the supporters something was done and there was violence? That's an improper election.
Okay, so that's what you mean by proper election.
Propriety in this case means that it was done the way it ought to be done, but the result will be studied by the party, just like the party has said, and if there are grounds for contention, they will contend. That's the party. Now, federal might, let me quickly disabuse our mind. I place this blame squarely on the PDP. They used to use federal might when it was, you know, then the then president Olusegun Obasanjo once said that election is a do or die affair. So they think that everybody operates in that same circumference. But the truth is, you can see the APC is a reformed party. And you told me now that the National Technical Committee chairman of APC congratulated the governor. So that shows you that there are reforms here and there. But that's not to say that you saw a propaganda machine that was so powerful, so humongous, so overwhelming. You know, you saw how a man who has done so much for this state, in the case now, Comrade Adams Oshiomhole, was immediately, is a khaki as a labor leader and a Democrat and a progressive, was removed. And they won him a new khaki of godfatherism that is now the new latest godfather in town. And you saw how they were, if you look very well, this godfatherism story sold more, they sold it more to the people than even their mega manifesto. However, all of that now is now political history. However,
do you think all of this happened because there was an opportunity to really look into that direction?
No, I give them credit.
Do you see that there was an opportunity
to look into that direction? Of course, I'm coming. I give them credit.
Okay.
When the victor played the victim, for example, we were all in this stage when Adams dropped in the airport and boys blocked him and they carried a truck for parking debt and use it to block his house and try to intimidate the man. And even the governor, the deputy governor, who is his son? I mean, literally, the deputy governor.
But we can't say that.
Yeah, the deputy governor has said it himself.
This is not the platform.
No, he said it.
Let's look at a situation where we can extract the electoral process because
yes, yes. Focus. So, in the final analysis, everything, look, election is a very tedious, very complicated process, and we have done that on Saturday. It's time for governance. Now the governor has no excuse whatsoever. So when we are talking to the governor now, he will not tell us that politicians want him to share money. He will not tell us that a certain godfather is holding him back. He has won election by the standard of INEC. It's time for him to go to work
and fulfill the promise.
There is no excuses now.
Okay, thank you.
So as I was saying, the street lights must work. At the Law College Road, erosion must be taken care of. Traditional ground, the erosion, the river, traditional ground there, we no longer need boats. We should no longer need boats to pass through Benin when it rains.
So
the governor must now go back. Yes! We must now go back to
you. Thank you.
There's no excuse for
you. Thank you. Now, as we wrap up, let's look at the aspect of vote buying, which crept into our polity. And there are various ways it can be described. Some say it started here in Edo State. Others say it's been with us inducement or one way or the other. You know, what do you think could be done? Because that also played out in this election.
Yeah, why respond to that? It played out, but everybody knows where it played out. The party that was dishing out. The areas I didn't want to delve into, but he has opened the Pandora's box, so we'd swim in the pool. As much as possible, within the rules.
You swim with caution, please.
You don't need to. There's something I always emphasize about the truth. What gives value to it is not the extreme of the emphasis you place on it. You don't need the extreme of conversancy with either coherence theory of truth or correspondence theory of truth to give value to the truth. Because the truth over time gives itself expression.
Really?
The reality will find itself everywhere. People, even the blind will see it. That is what is fundamental.
Mm.
That's why with reference to the sharing of money, we know those are shared money. I can say it boldly right here. Because of the personality of the governor, before I address all the issues he raised up, they went to meet him because he's normal. In the perception of some of the political pundits, that no matter what, there must be something in mind to mobilize voters. And the governor was point blank.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, he said, my friend who was with him when he made the comment told me in very clear terms. And I said, look, he drops his budget, no provision for voters. And I said, why? He said, look, if the people will not vote for me, let them not vote for me. But for any element of, as in finances to be earmarked for mobilizing voters, no. In fact, my friend said he used pidgin. He said, if people don't vote for me. That was the way he put it. So the guy's popularity doesn't change. That's his personality.
Right.
So
people share money.
Listen, if he says people share money at some point, I can tell you that maybe some persons on their own, some leaders, because they were scared, when they saw the other party, APC sharing 5,000, 10,000, 15,000, they were not scared that these are my people that really they like me and they support me. At all, let them buy something, give me 500 or 1,000 for my own purse. That is what happened.
Okay, so it played out.
I didn't say it played out. I said, yeah, it played out. don't quote me out of context.
Okay.
I said, yeah, it played out. There could be some business. If I'm, for example, in my unit, in my work, I'm a leader and election is going on, and I get a bit jittery because this is Nigeria. They say money can do some wonders. I see people that used to say they like me, they are giving me 10,000. And some of them, they've not seen 5,000 in the past 1 month. So because of fear, I may, on my own, go and borrow money from my folks and just say, okay, I thought, take 500, take, that's what I'm saying. I'm not sure that happened.
How do we address it?
Vote buying.
Because we have aspects where it's still being sponsored as a bill in the National Assembly.
No, of course, that's why I talked about the entire electoral process
okay.
being informed to ensure that the people are carried along, transparency is enhanced, the more the people believe in the process or in the system, some of what it says will just be a thing of the past. Nobody will mention it. Now, he made reference to a few things in the course of
talking. You have 1 minute?
The governor appointed about 7,000
Or more.
I said that's quite unfortunate. The entire government officials in the state, in fact, what women put together, is not going up to one third of that number is stated. The government is not going to appoint 300. Let me even tell him.
Interesting.
See, people that were appointed, you saw people that were resigning from different places because they wanted to go to the other side. And the governor, being a Democrat, felt that people should be represented. If from this ward, they have one person, for this government, they have three people, and they reside from the government, it would be unfair for the local government to have representation in the system. That was why he appointed people to replace those that have left. It's not in his business to be appointing people. You know him, a man who had approval for 12 special advisors in 2016. Up until the fourth year of his administration, it was barely seven he had appointed. That is about the least in the history of this fourth republic. So his pattern is a pattern of moderation and as in being conservative. That
Thank
is
you.
Good.
Thank you. I take that as your final words on this segment. You round up.
A pattern of moderation, but the pattern we want to see now is a pattern of development.
Okay, go ahead.
We can all agree that the governor was not elected because he has done exceedingly well. It's because they saw the hoax to majority of the people that the certain godfather was after him. Now that has been removed. So we must go back to development. We all need development.
Okay, but before you get there, let's look at the reforms.
Because of his performance.
Let's look at the reforms. Because I'm specifically after the reforms that could nip the issue of vote buying. That could nip it in the bud.
Well, like you said, the Nigeria is the poverty headquarter of the world. I don't agree with him, but I'm borrowing it for the sake of analysis.
It's just true because it's very important. We are talking to the public.
Yes.
If FIFA placed Nigeria in the ranking, do we agree with it?
No.
The ranking of Nigeria was delivered February 2018 by World Poverty Clock. They've been the ones doing it across the world.
I'm not contradicting you.
India was the headquarter before
there, but we can't make that as a basis of the discussion.
The point I'm making is that there's hunger in the land, largely because of the incompetence in government. And so it seems like government save money so that after 4 years, they will bring out the money to buy votes. So we hope and pray that this time around it will be all about development. Now, we must not also forget that what you have called certain people now, in another 4 years, it will be impossible for the governor to run for office as governor again.
I don't know if I asked this, but I remember
vote buying reforms.
Yes.
Now,
how do we leave this in the board?
What do we do?
Let's not digress.
It's to continue to tell politicians that they should not give money to the people. They should let people make their choices. What do we do? Do we make a there are legislations against those? Are they implemented? Are they justiciable? How do you know someone is buying vote? Do they wear party togas? Because on election day, you are not even allowed to carry your party logo to the polling unit. So how do you know who is buying vote, what and when and how?
Does that make it a difficult?
So it becomes a bit of a challenge for our security engines. So in the final analysis, we congratulated. I commend the people for the way we've conducted ourselves. We are all brothers. Let's go back to the drawing board. Development of Edo is key. Those of us on this side will continue to engage the governor to put him on his toe so that he will develop Edo State. Those on the other side should want to encourage him and work with him.
Okay.
So I learned that this development.
Okay. I'm extending the injury time.
There was something saying that no room for excuses. I was just correcting that. The governor never gave excuses. He gave the report of his performance.
Yes.
So he didn't give excuses in the first 4 years. He will not give excuses in the second 4 years. It's about performance. He hits the ground running. That's the truth. Now, coming to vote buying, in this election, there was even an answer to it to an extent. Because the people who paid money for people to vote for them were taking aback that as much as they paid, they lost their unit. Now, what does that speak to? It speaks to the process of the election. I was telling somebody that this is the first election in the past, I'm sure, by a decade or more, where I saw a semblance of open secret ballot.
Okay.
Because if somebody can go in and complaint and nobody looks at him or see him do it in any capacity of whatever party,
that would discover the act.
That is it.
Yes.
So it's always been like that.
The last election, even previous ones, most of the time, it becomes
there's
a cubicle, but enforcement of that open secret ballot sanctity wasn't there. Last election, I can tell you free of charge, somebody told me he wanted to vote because he was the leader of the party in his place. He didn't believe in his party candidate, the president, he didn't want to vote for him. But he said because the people that were looking at him, if he votes for the opposition, they say that the party, it will affect his status as a leader. But in this very election,
of course, it's anti party. You should go to the other party.
Listen, no, in this election, where I went to vote, everybody, there was privacy. The policemen did their job. It's only when you want somebody to go with you to go and tell you or guide you where to vote, that's when somebody goes along with you. Once open secret is sustained, people that give money will stop giving money because money does not produce results. Because no matter you try to stop it, so people can go and give people money 1 week before election. In one of the Western states, when they did election last year, we saw it happen, where they said they were giving money, even transferred to their accounts some days before election. So you cannot stop them from giving people money because they have a right to collect or give. They may not say it's that purpose that it's meant for. What matters is that the electoral process is enhanced, the sanctity is secured, people can vote their choice, and those who give money will keep their money in their pockets because the more you give, the more you lose.
Okay, thank you. Let's appraise the aspect of security agents. Agree with me that even the IG did say that 31,000 security personnel will be deployed in this election. And what do you make of the conduct of the security agents? And most especially the aspect of frowning against ballot box snatching?
I rate them very highly. It beats the imagination that even the PDP were apprehensive when they saw the number of persons, the security men that were coming, but they are surprised now that now they've won. They are surprised I praise them very highly. They conducted themselves absolutely well, and of course the way you appraise security is the nature of security in the election. There was no violence, so you give credit to the security men. If the election was manipulated, or you blame the INEC. If there was violence, you blame security men. You understand? So we praise it because there was no violence, and that is, for me, that is the peak of it. That is the highest win. That we did not go and put our lives on the line because of politicians. Now, about vote buying, he talked about. We know a party whose mantra is.
I only asked you about security. Now, we mustn't hit the policy. Now, let's get to know this, that what we're doing here, we are educating.
We are trying to get out.
No. Yes, election has.
So I commend
you. Like you said, we should be looking at governance.
Yes, governance now.
I thought this conversation about the elections to raise sentiments.
Okay.
That's not the essence of this.
So we commend the security, and
okay,
to God be the glory, there was no violence.
Thank you. In 1 minute, your opinion about the performance of the security agents.
Why I opine on the performance security agent, just to correct something, please. He said the PDP was apprehensive. Not one daily, not two, not three. It was only all the dailies where the PDP campaign council appreciated the federal government. That was before the election, for the deployment of security to those states for the election. If they were apprehensive, would they be appreciating the federal government and the institutions that deployed the security men? There was no such stuff, just to clear the air on that. Now, talking about security, yes, we commend them. I still go back to the point I highlighted earlier, after the beginning of our discourse, after we started the discourse, that elections should not be like that. We should go beyond this level. That they have to deploy about 31,000 policemen to one state.
31,000 security personnel.
Yes.
That cut across
the entire gamut.
31,000 security personnel to Edo State for election. How many security men do we have in total? Some of the police, the army, the NCDC, and all the NSCDC. Some of them, how many are they? Let's ensure the process becomes more transparent so that we can do like not even Western countries. Neighboring countries in West Africa here, when they do elections, students go to school.
Yeah.
They do elections, people go to work. Every time we cancel activities for a day because of election. Last year, the National Association of the president of the National Association of Nigerian Traders, he said that traders across the country, on a conservative note, lost 140 billion naira. We shouldn't be doing this. Time is money.
So as a serious nation, we should go to the point where people can vote from the comfort of their home. That's why I said the electoral act should be signed into law. There should be improvement in about 420 BC, before the time of Christ. Philosopher Confucius made a very tacit statement. He said there are three means by which men learn wisdom. He said the first one is by imitation. He said the first one is by he said the first one is by reflection, which is noblest. I want to use this. No, the English there was different. He said the first one is by reflection, which is noblest. He said the second one is by imitation, which is easy. He said the third one is by experience, which is bitterest. That guy made that comment about 420 BC. As a nation state, I feel ashamed that we learn by experience rather than learning by reflection. And we keep repeating things and living with injuries rather than avoiding them when necessary.
Thank you, Frank Ayerson, for taking our time and for being articulate on this. And a big thanks to you,
Idris Zekary. God bless you
for being articulate and also taking time to be part of this show.
Thank you.
That's where we call it a wrap on the discussion segment. It's still this morning on ITV. Stay with me.